Chris Sarra, thanks for joining me.
Thank you. Great to be with you.
Well, firstly, let's just start at the beginning. What was it like for you growing up in the Queensland town of Bundaberg, the youngest of 10 children? And what were some of your experiences going to school as an Indigenous child?
Being a part of such a big family was a wonderful thing. But in the 70s, Joh Bjelke-Petersen was the premier. It was a time when racism was okay to exist. But in many ways, I had a very strong Aboriginal mother, very proud Italian father, and we were kind of taught how to deal with racism in such a way that we weren't victims to it.
What was it that led you to becoming a teacher and have this love and passion for education?
In some ways, Karla, I stumbled into teaching, and it just happened that when I finished high school, I was given a special opportunity, and I was given special entry into Teachers College because they wanted to get more Aboriginal teachers into secondary schools, and so I was fortunate enough to finish high school at a time when they were looking to get more people in.
You've carried that sort of passion for education further. Why have you decided to go down that path?
I wanted to change expectations of Aboriginal kids right across Australia, because if I had been sold short, I was wondering how many other black kids have been sold short just because teachers didn't believe in them. And so that's what I wanted my career to be about, changing expectations of Aboriginal children right across Australia.
Well, you did just that, and in 1998 you became the first Aboriginal principal of Cherbourg State School in southeast Queensland. You were widely credited with changing the situation at the school with the philosophy of strong and smart, which saw attendance rates improve. Can you tell us about the issues that you were faced when you first took over as principal, and what measures did you put in place to turn things around through the strong and smart approach?
Really, when I think of my time at Cherbourg, and it sounds easy to reflect on, but the truth is we worked hard, and it wasn't just me, it was me working in partnership with some teachers who were working their guts out with Aboriginal community members. And when I went to Cherbourg, it was a very... it was a special time, but I went in with some kind of personal sentiment about just knowing how devastating and how toxic this low expectations can be, and having transcended those in an individual sense, I was looking in front of me and seeing a team that I'd inherited colluding with this kind of negative stereotypical view of Aboriginal children and Aboriginal community school.
Why do you think that existed at the time?
It existed because it was allowed to exist, and nobody had ever seriously challenged it. I had a choice. I could either collude with that circumstance and allow it to continue to be true, or I could set about smashing it to bits. And I think knowing that I'd smashed those negative perceptions to bits about myself and those low expectations of me, I knew I could smash it. It was going to be hard work. But if I worked with the people around me, that we could do it, and we did. But that doesn't mean the work isn't hard. And I always believed that we could make a difference. And I said to the kids on the very first assembly, I said, the most important thing that you will learn from me is that you can be Aboriginal and you can be successful. And I was intent on challenging them from that moment on until I left, and I still continue to challenge them. And I think if I reflect on the hardest parts was not getting the community to come on board, not getting kids to buy into the notion that they could be strong and proud to be Aboriginal and they could be as smart as white kids. The hardest part, I think, was getting the team that I'd inherited, was getting them to believe what I was believing. Because the parents and the community and the kids, they were hearing something different and they liked what they heard. And as a blackfella, I knew that we wanted kids to be smart enough so that they can mix it with any other kid in any other school, but not at the expense of our sense of cultural identity. So we wanted an education that was not going to make us like white kids. We wanted to be as smart as them, but not the same as them. So as smart as them and have a strong sense of cultural identity. So that's where we got the strong and the smart. And from then on, it was just a matter of hard work and continuing to challenge until we delivered on that promise.
What do you believe was the key to changing the educational outcomes for the students and increase community participation at Cherbourg School?
A lot of people talk about the challenges in Aboriginal communities and with Aboriginal students and with any kids who are marginalised. They say, oh, well, parents don't value education. And then when I look and I kind of reflect on the history of some of those parents and their time at school, I think, why the hell would they value education if it's done that, if they've had such a negative experience with schooling? So we need to put that into context. But we also need to understand that as educators, we're paid to be in a relationship with children at the school. So yes, things like alcoholism, things like parents not valuing education, those complexities do exist. But as teachers, we've got limited extent to which we can control those very complex factors. As a teacher in a classroom, what I'm better off doing is focusing on the things that I'm being paid to do, and that is to be an exceptional teacher. So when I've got those children in the morning in my classroom, I want it to be a first-class learning environment. I want my children in this classroom to have the kind of education that I would want for my own children. And that's what we should be focused on.
What do you think other schools around the country can learn from the Cherbourg experience?
I like that for Aboriginal communities right across Australia, we expose them to a different reality. And it was a reality in which their children could be as good as white children. It was a reality in which they could go to school and not feel marginalised and not feel like they had to leave their cultural identity at the school gate and pick it up on the way home. They could actually bring it in and celebrate and have it fulfilled in every magical and most wonderful way. So we exposed Aboriginal communities to that new reality, which is a great privilege.
When you saw that the kids could realise that being successful and be achievers was a good thing, what were the changes that you actually saw in the children?
It's quite a magical thing when you watch kids who have become so entrenched in a sense of despair be exposed to something positive and something like Strong and Smart, and then all of a sudden be energised by that. And it's why I won't ever accept from any educator or any politician or any blackfella who says, well, we can't make a difference in the lives of Aboriginal children because their home lives are so complex. I've seen tough times and I've seen kids confronted by quite dramatic complexity, yet transcend those complexities because they loved what was happening at school. They loved the fact that, yes, they might have lived in complex circumstances, but they knew that with Stronger, Smarter, they could find a way to transcend those complexities that they lived amongst, you know. Those challenges exist because of other sociological and historical complexities. They don't exist because of the legacy of being Aboriginal. And once we got kids to understand that, kids as young as 5 and 6, some real change occurred.
Well, in 2005, 8 years after serving as principal of Cherbourg School, you left, and in 2006 you set up the Indigenous Education Leadership Institute, which then later became the Stronger Smarter Institute. Can you just tell us about the work of the Stronger Smarter Institute and why you saw a need to set it up?
When I left Cherbourg School, I was pretty tired, and I was 7 years there, and that's about enough time to be able to cause a shift in terms of the culture of the school. And it made sense that if we had unlocked the keys to success in that environment, then we should share those keys. You know, like attendance, real attendance at the school went from 62 to 94%. We didn't even think about cutting parents' welfare payments or any big stick measures like that. We just made a school that kids wanted to turn up to and that parents would be happy to see their kids be involved in. Literacy and numeracy results surged in our school. So if we discovered those things, then it made sense to share those messages with other schools.
You said that ensuring that children have a positive sense of their own cultural identity is a key to learning. It's not just about making kids smarter. How do you work with schools around the country to achieve this?
When we talk about the Stronger, Smarter approach, we want people to understand the overarching framework and that this is not about Aboriginal culture, this is about school and community culture. It's about embracing positive community leadership as opposed to embracing that kind of being the victim or booting the victim type Aboriginal leadership. I'm not silly enough, and I've seen other blackfellas make the mistake of thinking that they can have the magic bullet that's going to fix things in communities. It doesn't work like that for blackfellas, and it doesn't work like that for educators. what we need them to do is understand the overarching philosophical framework that is about high expectations relationships and work together, school and community leadership, so that they can apply that in their in whatever form that exists, and that's whatever form is relevant to their own school and community context.
We've discussed your own personal experiences working as a principal of Cherbourg and the work of the Stronger Smarter Institute. And I now want to delve into some of the issues raised in Testing Teachers, a new three-part series which sees six new young teaching graduates placed in three schools in Melbourne, Perth and Tennant Creek in the Northern Territory, a place where alcohol consumption in the town is two times the national average. Most children have experienced or witnessed domestic violence. The school has 230 students enrolled, 85% who are Indigenous, and on most days there are 40% no-shows. So when you look at those factors, how difficult is it to get kids to school and turn things around for the better?
I've been to Tennant Creek, and I visited the school that we've seen, but I don't pretend for a moment to have a full appreciation of the extent of the complexities. But as an educator, I'm just determined to look for the strengths that exist in communities. So what I want to see is teachers who would be determined to make a difference, and you kind of see that. But I'm not seeing any sense of connectedness to the community or the family. And so it disappoints me in any school if I just saw a teacher who stands in the classroom and waits for children to turn up.
Do you want to check at the front office?
Yeah.
And I think the only way that we can have a chance at addressing some of those challenges is to stop being victims to the complexities of that circumstance, and put a mirror up and saying, okay, let's think about the things that we control. Let's think about the things that we're accountable for. Let's think about the things that we get paid to do here. And let's set about influencing those things. If I'm a teacher in any community that where alcoholism exists and other complexities, I've got no chance of changing those complexities. I only control my relationship with my students. And knowing that, in that relationship, I want it to be so special, so positive. I want to know, if you're my student, I want to know where you're coming from. I want to know about the baggage that you carry to school. I want to know if you're getting a good night's sleep at night. And if you're not, how can I work with you so that I can help you to be the best student that you can be? And that's going to take some work, and it's going to take time. Because I need to get out of the classroom, and I need to find my way into your life so that I can understand what's going on for you. Now, if I'm in a remote community, I'm not going to do that locked in my classroom or locked in a compound at the end of the day. But I would learn some stuff if I went and watched you play football or netball on the weekend. And you would learn some stuff about me too if you heard me cheering for you at the netball game on the weekend, or if I'm asking you about how many fish you caught, or if I show that I'm genuinely interested in what your life is about, you might start to get a sense that maybe I do care about you, and maybe I do want you to learn and be the best that you can be.
Quick, and you've got to show me you can work well, otherwise I'm going to send you. Last opportunity, mate. Otherwise it's gone.
How difficult is it, do you think, for a non-Indigenous teacher, a new young graduate, going into a school like Tennant Creek? What sort of challenges would they face? And we have seen in this series a number of challenges that they do face, language barriers, cultural barriers.
I got to say, Karla, when I look at the teachers on display, I struggle to come to grips with the notion that they can be trained in 6 weeks and then be launched into my profession. It doesn't matter how bright they are. This is a profession, and that must be acknowledged. And that's part of the complexity here, that these teachers are ill-equipped to be a part of our profession, and so more work needs to be done on that.
What's 2 + 2?
On the question of non-Indigenous teachers with Aboriginal students, we need to be clear that those teachers, first and foremost, need to be high-quality teachers. I'm okay with the fact that they may not be experts in Aboriginal culture. In fact, if you give me a choice between an expert teacher and somebody who's an expert on Aboriginal culture, but all they want to do is feel sorry for kids. I'm going to take the expert teacher every time because they're going to push hard. Now, that expert teacher, of course, I will want them to develop a better understanding of where kids are coming from, and they would do that anyway.
Many of the schools around the country have introduced a pickup service where a community member would collect them and take them to school.
Morning. Didn't come home last night.
How effective are these types of services in getting kids to school?
There's a whole range of different ways of addressing things like attendance, things like getting kids to school in the morning. Those kinds of strategies might exist differently. So in one community, you might have parents who'll say, yeah, we want a breakfast program because we want the kids well fed and ready to learn. But in another community, they might say, that's my business. I don't want the school taking over my responsibilities as a parent. I'm seeing a disconnect between the school leadership and the community leadership. And if there was more Aboriginal people employed as part of the solution, then things would not seem so complex, I would guess.
So you're saying that the school needs to work with the community in order to get those kids to school, therefore increasing school attendance and so on?
Yes, the community is complex, but the school's only chance is to get better connected in an honourable way in what I would call a high expectations relationship with the community and develop a shared sense of purpose about what sort of children they want. Now, the biggest challenge in there, I think, is getting non-Indigenous teachers who are sent into that circumstance to actually believe that those kids can be as good as anybody else.
Do you think more cultural awareness training would help when they're training to become teachers?
Sometimes, as educators, I think we're a bit naive when we just assume that if we get cross-cultural training, that's going to be the solution. But the truth is, what it comes down to is getting to know the children and what baggage they carry and getting to know the community. Because simply, there is no cross-cultural training that I can learn that will equip me to teach in Tennant Creek, for instance, where this young teacher is.
Because every community is different.
Every community is so different. And the place where I learn about the complexities and the cultural nuances and the things that are going to excite kids and make them better learners in Tennant Creek is in Tennant Creek and in the community. That's where I need to understand that. So it's not quite right to think that cross-cultural training is the answer. The ultimate answer is to be in a relationship, a high expectations relationship with children and with their community. In our efforts, we talk a lot about the head, the heart and the hand, and those three things must be aligned. And so when it comes to things like cultural awareness, that's a very cognitive kind of function and it exists in the head. But it can be useless if you're not connected to your students and your community by a sense of heart. And when you do that, then you can be affected by what you come to learn, you know, about the kind of conditions that kids are living in.
What happened?
I don't know.
Because it was really obvious you weren't happy when you left.
Just pissed off.
Yeah, I know, and I don't want you to feel that way.
But they just need to know those things with their head and be connected with their heart so that they can do business differently with their hands. And that could mean anything in a community. So yes, there are challenges like things like sorry business and those kinds of things. But if there is a sense of understanding about that and a connection to the people in a way that's authentic, then any challenge can be overcome.
How can teachers and parents work together for better educational outcomes so that we are seeing more kids finishing high school and going on to tertiary studies?
When I think back to my time at Sherbourg, and I used to pretend that every child in that school was my child, and when I would talk to teachers about the quality of the learning that was going on in their classroom, the question that was always in my mind was, are you the kind of teacher that I would let teach my child? And if the answer was no, then there's no way I was going to let you teach the children of Sherbourg. And so that's what I mean by making it personal. And then beyond that, it's a matter of reaching out to parents and getting them involved in the conversation. I remember pulling up at one guy's door on the way home from school, and he looked at me and he said, oh, what the fuck has he done now? You know, talking about his kid, because he was so used to school people just coming up to tell him how bad his kid was. And I said, no, everything's going fine. He's doing really well. And you know something? Your kid is really smart, and I just want you to know that. So I showed him his book. I said, look, can you see how his writing is changing? As we get more into the year, it's getting tighter, it's getting better, and he's writing more. And this guy was, I think he was gobsmacked at the time, because he was just so used to hearing about how bad his kid was. But I was determined to find a way to let him know that some strengths existed in his, with his boy, and that he was good. And I don't think we do enough of that. And we've got to be prepared to get outside the school gate and not be so intimidated by the complexities that exist, because most of the time those complexities only exist in our heads. And if we have the courage to step out and just have a yarn with Aboriginal parents, there are some truly magical relationships to be had out in communities.
How do we make it enjoyable for them in a place that they want to be, so that they keep on coming?
When you run a school or you run a classroom, the question is always, how do we hook them? How do we get them involved? And sometimes the content is not always cool, but it's important. And you just have that yarn with kids, and it's let them know, explain to them why it's important, you know? So when I talk to kids about, okay, we've got to do writing, but you know what? Writing is power. If you can write, that means you can put your views out into the world. You can put them on blogs, you can put them in the newspaper and stuff like that.
We bring on challenges for you, and we put you to the test.
We can embrace that power that comes with reading and writing. So come on, let's just do this, and let's get the power that exists, and let's be the best that we can be.
Well, governments talk about closing the gap in education between Indigenous and non-Indigenous kids. What do you think is the key to that? How can we solve this?
I get a little bit annoyed when I hear about this closing the gap kind of thing, because it kind of presents this circumstance where it says, like, black fellas are over here and white fellas are over here, and then we have to jump across there to be as good as the average white person. When really there's a whole bunch of Aboriginal kids who are achieving really well. So it's like shifting a bell curve to the right, because there are a lot of young Aboriginal, Torres Strait Islander men and women in schools who are exceptional. And so we need to embrace that and celebrate that, and inspire other kids with that, and inspire teachers to know that yes, there are some exceptional young Aboriginal students out there, and that there are some kids who are might be getting D's, but if we just push a little bit harder, we can get them getting C's and then B's. It's not all about that really hardcore end. So when we get it into perspective, we understand that, yes, this is complex. Yes, this is hard work. But we can do this. We can make a difference.
Dr. Chris Sarra, thanks very much for joining us.
Thank you.